Thank you, preacher. It is a blessing and a privilege to be here with you folks today in Euclid, and we enjoyed the morning service and a little fellowship this afternoon and a little nap this afternoon. We enjoyed that. And looking forward to what the Lord has for us tonight. Take your Bible, if you would, and open it up to the book of Hebrews. Hebrews chapter 12. Hebrews chapter number 12. Beginning in verse number 12, that's where I'll start to read. It says, "Wherefore lift up the hands which hang down, and the feeble knees, and make straight paths for your feet, lest that which is lame be turned out of the way, but let it rather be healed. Follow peace with all men and holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord, looking diligently, lest any man fail of the grace of God, lest any root of bitterness springing up trouble you, and thereby many be defiled." Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for the beautiful day that you gave to us today, for the good services this morning and the good attendance. And Lord, I pray that your word would truly take root in hearts and lives of those that heard this morning, maybe some that were here lost without Christ. God, I pray that they would come back and they would come often, and Lord, they'd be saved soon. Lord, we just never know how long we have, how many opportunities we have. And Lord, tonight we have another opportunity to look into your word, allow your Holy Spirit to speak to our hearts. And God, I pray that you'd do just that tonight. And if there's one here tonight, not saved, not born again, not truly redeemed by the blood of Jesus Christ, I pray that tonight would indeed be the night when they would know what it means to have their sins forgiven and know what it means to be a child of God. We'll thank you for all that you do in Jesus' name. Amen. Now I want you to look, if you would, at verse number 15, the last verse that we read. It says, "Looking diligently, lest any man fail of the grace of God, lest any root of bitterness springing up trouble you, and thereby many be defiled." I want to preach to you a little bit about bitterness tonight. But just for the sake of time, can we just agree that bitterness is a sin? We won't have to go into detail trying to prove that. I think we all know that, don't we? I mean, if you harbor bitterness in your heart, that is a sin. Without a doubt, it's sin. But it's a sin that, well, it's not like other sins. It's hard to deal with. It's hard. Some sins are easier to spot and easier to fix. Bitterness is hard to deal with for a couple reasons. First of all, because it's easy to hide. It's easy to hide. If I catch you being bitter and I say, "Now, Brother Rusnecko, aren't you getting a little bitter over that thing?" He'd say, "Oh, no. I'm not bitter. You just misunderstood what I said." You see, it's easy for us to hide it. We'll say, "Oh, no. I'm not really. I shouldn't have said that, or I shouldn't have said it that way. I'm not bitter." It's easy to hide it. The second reason it's hard to deal with is because, well, there's nobody here but us, so we'll tell the truth, okay? We like it. It makes us feel good sometimes. It does. It makes us feel good. And, you know, somebody did something terrible to us, and now we're all bitter about it, and we almost feel good because they're low down and sorry and no good, and we've been wronged, and somehow we just makes us feel a little better, a little spiritual, to know that we weren't the low down sorry one that did the wrong. And we're bitter and angry at somebody, and we feel justified in it. Like we deserve to be bitter. And they deserve for us to be bitter at them. That makes it very hard to deal with. It's easy to hide, and it feeds our flesh. We like it. But you've already agreed with me tonight that it's a sin. So with that in mind, we need to deal with it. Amen? So I want to give you some things tonight about bitterness. First of all, I want to give you some of the causes, and there are multitudes that we'll not cover. I just want to give you some of the big ones, all right? Some of the causes, and then I want to give you the curse that goes along with it, why it's so damaging, why it's so dangerous, and then I want to give you the cure. I like problems with a cure. I don't like unsolvable problems, amen? That's why I'm not interested in the upcoming election. I don't like unsolvable problems. I like problems with a cure. Amen? And this one has a cure, and I'm going to give it to you tonight. First of all, I want you to see some of the causes of bitterness. The first one is found in Ephesians chapter 6. Leave something in Hebrews 12. We're coming back there. But go to Ephesians chapter number 6. And the first area I want to talk to you about tonight is bitterness at parents. Ephesians chapter 6, verse number 4. And ye fathers, provoke not your children to wrath, but bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. Bitterness at parents. You say, well, you should be talking to teenagers, or you should be talking to children if you're talking about bitterness at parents. No. You see, the truth is, in good, sound, fundamental, Bible-believing, independent Baptist churches, we find adult people, people in their 20s and 30s and 40s and even older, who are still bitter and angry at their parents over things that happened 30 years ago. Still bitter and still angry. And here's the problem with bitterness. It doesn't hurt the person you're bitter at, but it will destroy your life. And so when you carry that bitterness from childhood on into adulthood, it will destroy your own family and your own relationships, and it will destroy your life. If for no other reason, you ought to get rid of it, because it'll damage your life. Bitterness at parents. I've met folks, adult people, active in church and active in serving God, who are still bitter and angry at their parents over things that they felt happened to them when they were a child. How many of you had or have brothers and sisters? At least you had at least one sibling. Okay. Now, be honest. I know we're in church, but be honest, okay? You don't have to impress anybody. How many of you at some point you felt like your brother or sister got treated better than you did? At least once. Oh boy, those hands went up fast. Amen. And the rest of you are lying. Because every kid thinks that sooner or later. They really do. You look around, you say, well, why did she get to do that when I didn't get to do that? Why did he get to stay out till that time when I had to be in at this time? When he did it, nobody said anything. But when I did it, suddenly the sky falls and I'm in trouble and it's a terrible thing. It's just not fair. Have you parents ever heard that? Yeah. And the sad thing is, you probably said it at one point or another in your life. Oh, maybe not out loud, but in your heart you said, it's just not fair. They're treating that one better than they're treating me. Now, even though that may be completely unjustified, the devil's smart enough to know that it's still fertile ground in which to plant seeds of bitterness. It doesn't matter if it's legitimate or not. He'll plant seeds of bitterness, and that bitterness is real, and that will follow you through your life if you don't deal with it. I'm the youngest of five. Praise the Lord, my parents kept going until they got it right. As the youngest of five, I was always mistreated and got the short end of the stick. And it's always the hardest to be the youngest. You're just mistreated and abused, and you must not be the youngest. Oh, all those who are the youngest know my pain. The rest of you just don't understand. You think the youngest one got away with murder. That's what you think. But you're wrong. You're wrong. We were abused and mistreated. It was terrible. You know, if you lined up my three brothers and my sister and myself, you lined us all up here from the oldest to the youngest, and you asked each one of us who got treated the best and who got treated the worst, I dare say there'd be some disagreement. I think there would. My oldest brother might point all the way down to the end and say, well, by the time he came along, mom and dad got soft. You know, and they were letting him get away with stuff. And I might point up there further and say, well, they got to do stuff I never got to do. And they got to go places I never got to go. And we'd be pointing back and forth at each other. And we'd all point at my sister and we'd say, well, she got away with murder because she was the only girl. And she did. And still does. But you know what? The truth is, you parents know, all of your kids are different. They're all different. And you, as much as you want to be fair and reasonable, you cannot treat them all exactly the same. They need to be treated a little differently because they're unique, different personalities, and they're different people. And you're not being unjust and unfair. You're just trying to be wise and discerning. That's all. And sometimes the devil will see some of that frustration on the part of the child and plant some seeds of bitterness. Or sometimes there will be some real hurts. Oh, I know. I've met folks in places that told me stories of their childhood, just horrendous, horrible things. terrible things that were done to them in their own home by their own family members, just horrible, wicked, vile things that were done to them. And how hard it is for them to deal with that, how hard it is for them to forgive. But listen, let me tell you again. Maybe it was some real horrible, terrible thing that happened in your life. But if there are seeds of bitterness planted, that bitterness is going to follow you through the rest of your life and destroy the rest of it. Sometimes it happens when a child is provoked to wrath, like it talks about here in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 4. It says, "Fathers, provoke not your children to wrath, but bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord." Listen, when we fail to do that as Christian parents, we're setting our children up to be bitter. We really are. I've been in places, but one of my least favorite, I'll just tell you the truth, one of my least favorite places to preach is in a Christian school chapel. I'd rather preach in a prison. I'd rather preach on the street. I'd rather have my toenails pulled out than preach in a Christian school chapel. Now, that's not always the case. I've been in some that were just a wonderful blessing and exciting, but more times than not, it's a horrible experience. You come in and there's a whole group of young people sitting there with their arms crossed and a foul look on their face. It's supposed to be Christian young people, supposed to be in a Christian school training to live for God and serve God, and they have this nasty scowl on their face like you've just done the worst thing you could possibly do by insisting that they show up and listen to somebody preach the Bible, of all things. My wife says I preach different when I preach in school chapels. She says I'm not as nice. She says I tend to be mean when I preach in school chapels. And it's probably true. I don't mean to on purpose. It just comes out. You know, I want to grab them in Christian love and slap them upside the face. You know what the problem is a lot of times? The problem is a lot of times that they go to a home, they live in a home where they're told that stuff they tell you at school, those standards you have to follow and the dress codes and all that. Well, you just do that because that's what we have to do to stay in school. That's not really that important. And that stuff they're telling you, it's not really that important. It's not that big a deal. And the problem is that young people can smell hypocrites a mile away. And when you tell them we do one thing at home and we do a different thing at school, we do one thing at home and a different thing at church, what you're doing is plowing up the soil in their life to make them fertile ground for seeds of bitterness to be planted. That's not bringing them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. That's preparing them for bitterness. And some of those kids, unless God gets a hold of their heart somewhere along the line, as soon as they're out from under mom and dad and out from under the pressure of that Christian school, they'll be gone and they'll never be back in church, which is sad. Well, I'm not just making that up. I went to one of those. I graduated from one of those. Amen? I did. There were five of us in our graduating class. I think there are two of us still in church. Out of five. That's not real good for a Christian school, is it? But you'd probably find that to be true in most. Probably true in most. That's a sad thing. Sad thing. It ought not be that way. And I think we can lay the blame in a lot of places, but the truth is we need to just bring it back home and say that we really have not quite brought them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. We've expected them to get their religious training when we send them off to the school or off to the Sunday school, and we've forgotten about it at home, and we've set them up to become bitter young people. Bitterness at parents. Here's the second thing. It's bitterness at peers. Look at Psalm 55, if you would. Psalm 55, verse number 12. "For it was not an enemy that reproached me, then I could have borne it. Neither was it he that hated me that did magnify himself against me. Then I would have hid myself from him. But it was thou, a man mine equal, my guide, and mine acquaintance. We took sweet counsel together and walked into the house of God in company." David was the one who penned this psalm under the inspiration of the Spirit of God. And he said it was my friend that hurt me. It was my friend that turned on me and reproached me and magnified himself against me. So we served God together. We went to the house of God together. He was my equal and my guide and my acquaintance. It could be that somewhere along the line, somebody you know, somebody you love, somebody you spent time with, somebody you went to church with might turn on you and hurt you. So all that'll never happen. All my friends are Christians. Hang on. It can happen, even among Christians. It can. And when that happens, the devil knows that he can often plant seeds of bitterness that will then infect your life and destroy your life on down the road. Bitterness appears. David said he reproached me and he magnified himself against me. Reproach just means to be brought to shame and embarrassment. Magnified himself against me. Have you ever met somebody that took delight in tearing people down so that they seemed to be more important and more spiritual? That's what happened to David. And it wasn't some enemy that had hated him all of his life. It was his friend. It was his friend. Bitterness at peers. Here's the third area. Go back to Hebrews chapter 12. Hebrews chapter 12, verse number 5. And you have forgotten the exhortation which speaketh unto you as unto children. My son, despise not thou the chastening of the Lord, nor faint when thou art rebuked of him. For whom the Lord loveth, he chasteneth, and scourgeth every son whom he receiveth. The third area is this: bitterness at God. There are a lot of folks out there tonight that are bitter at God. They really are. Oh, they wouldn't necessarily say that and admit to it, but they are. So one way you can tell is what happens to them when they leave. When they get mad and they get angry and they leave the church, just see what happens. Where do they go? Quite often they'll say, well, I just can't work with that preacher. And we just have a personality conflict and I just can't sit under his ministry anymore. And he just doesn't feed me and all this and that and blah, blah, blah. And on it goes. If all that were true, then they would just go find another church with a different preacher and get involved and serve God. If the preacher really were the problem. You know what the real problem is? They're angry at God. They're bitter at God. How do you know that? Because they drop out altogether and they're sitting at home tonight, not serving God anyplace. Just stewing in their bitterness and their anger. Just mark it down. Their problem is not with a deacon or with a preacher or with the nursery worker or whoever it was. Their problem is with God. It's with God. People get bitter at God over this silliest stuff. I met a lady one night and I was preaching along these lines and she came to me after church and she literally was in tears and she told me her problem. She said, I've been bitter at God for years. I said, why? She said, well, because of my nose. I said, your nose? She said, yeah. She said, it's huge. And I looked at it and it was noticeable. It was a pretty good nose. It was. It was a downright respectable nose. I said, ma'am, don't waste your life being bitter over that. God didn't do that to you and curse you. She thought God had cursed her with a big nose. Really, honestly, I'm not making it up. Listen, that's a waste of your life to be angry at God over those things. Well, I'm mad at God because I'm not where I want to be or I don't live where I want to live or I'm the wrong size or shape and it's God's fault. No. Listen, God has dumped blessings all over us. Why don't you look at some of those for a while? And we are the most blessed people in all the world. Well, it was just the 4th of July this past couple days. Now, listen, we have our problems, but this is still the greatest country in all the world. It is. I guarantee there's no other place you'd rather live. Just go try it for a while. You'd be glad to come back. There's no place that has the freedom that we have. No place has the liberty that we have. And no place has the prosperity that we have. Really. And it's just the result of the blessing of God over the past. And we're still reaping the blessings from that. We ought to rejoice in what God has given us. And yeah, you may have some problems and you may have some difficulties and you may have some things you wish were a little different, but thank God for the things that He's given you. Amen. He's given you a lot more than He's taken. A whole lot more. He always does. People are bitter at God. I've met folks that were bitter at God because they couldn't find somebody to marry. I met other people that were bitter at God because they did find somebody to marry. Yeah. Now they're stuck and they're blaming God. People get bitter at God sometimes when the Lord reproaches them. Like it talked about here in Hebrews chapter 12. Rebukes them. Have you ever been rebuked by God? If you're here tonight and you're saved, it's because one day God rebuked you. He did. God sent rebuke and said, you are a sinner. You can't save yourself. You need a Savior. And he sent rebuke right to you. And you know what you did? If you got saved, what you did is that you accepted the rebuke. If you don't accept the rebuke when God sends rebuke, you end up getting mad at God. How dare that preacher say those things? Instead of thank God for the rebuke and trusting what it says. Amen. God's going to send you rebuke. And he's going to send you chastisement. He promised to do it. Sometimes God sends rebuke when you least expect it. Really. Quite often it happens when you're just sitting in church. You're listening to the message. The preacher's preaching along, waxing eloquent, maybe even spitting a little bit. It could happen. So I'll just stay back here. And all of a sudden you get the distinct impression that he's been digging through your garbage. And he knows where you've been and he knows what you did. And he's found it all out somehow and he's telling everybody. And the truth is, what just happened is that God rebuked you. Chances are he doesn't have a clue what you've been up to. He doesn't have any idea at all. But he's just preaching what God put on his heart, and God made a rebuke with your name on it and sent it right to you. Now you can either accept the rebuke or you can get mad and get upset. I recommend that you accept the rebuke, because if you don't, you're just going to get bitter. Get bitter and angry. When the chastening of God comes, sometimes folks get angry. You know, God promised in this passage, we won't read it all, but you can go down to verse number 11 where it says, no chastening for the present seemeth to be joyous, but grievous. Chastening hurts. But God promised that if we're his children, he will send it into our lives to keep us going the right way. We start to live in rebellion and we start to do things that are not right, and God will send chastisement into our lives to get us back to where we need to be. When that happens, you ought to just jump up and down and thank God. Because that's just a reminder that he's your heavenly Father and he loves you. What a wonderful reminder. If you don't do that, you'll probably get mad at God for sending chastisement. I've met people who chose to live in open, wicked rebellion against God. People who claim to be saved, living in wicked rebellion against God, and God sends chastisement into their lives. And instead of recognizing it and getting right, they get mad at God for allowing bad things to happen to them. That's the wrong answer. It just gets worse and worse and worse. When God sends chastisement, you ought to stop and say, whoop, what's wrong? What needs to be fixed? What'd I do? Where'd I go astray and get the thing straightened out and get it right and go on and serve God? Otherwise, you're going to get bitter and you're going to get angry, and that bitterness is going to follow you and it's going to ruin your life. Bitterness at parents and bitterness at peers and bitterness at God. Those are just three. There are multitudes of areas where Satan begins to plant the seeds of bitterness in our lives. But I want to move on to why it's so dangerous, the curse that goes along with it. Look back at Ephesians chapter 4 this time. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 30. And grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby ye are sealed unto the day of redemption. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. The first reason that it's so dangerous, the first part of the curse that goes along with it, is that it grieves the Holy Spirit of God. God said, if you want to keep from grieving the Spirit, what you need to do is get rid of the first thing, get rid of bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor. You can't have bitterness and wrath and anger and still have the Holy Spirit of God doing the work he needs to do in your life.
you'll grieve the Spirit of God. I don't know about you, and I probably shouldn't tell you this because my wife is here, and she doesn't know this. But I'm going to tell you. I'm slow and stubborn. She doesn't know that. And she, even after I said it, she still doesn't believe it. I'm sure I can tell by the look on her face. She just doesn't believe that to be true. But it is true. And what that means is that on a good day, I mean on a good day, when I'm just really super spiritual, it's still hard for the Spirit of God to lead me and guide me and direct me, because I'm slow and stubborn. That's right. The last thing I need is something else in my life that will make it even harder for the Spirit of God to do His work in my heart. So if I can get rid of something that's going to grieve the Spirit of God, I'm going to get rid of it. Bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, evil speaking. God said those things have to go, or you will grieve the Spirit of God. Here's the second thing. It hinders your service to God. We won't go there for the sake of time, but in Matthew chapter 5, verses 22 down through verse 24, you know the instance. Jesus said, if your brother has aught against you, leave your gift at the altar and go and reconcile with your brother. You see, if you harbor bitterness in your heart, it's going to hinder your service to God. Jesus said, as long as you're fighting with the guy back there, don't come up here and leave your gift and tell everybody how much you love God and how much you want to serve God. Don't stand up and give a testimony and tell everybody how much you love Jesus when you won't talk to the guy sitting on the other side of the room. Go fix the problem. And then stand up and tell us all how much you love Jesus, how much you want to serve God. Then it means something. Up until that point, it's just hot air. And that bitterness that you hold in your heart is keeping you from doing what you would even desire to do for God. And keeping you from being what you ought to be for the cause of Christ. It hinders your service to God. Here's the third thing. Leave something in Ephesians 4. Go back to Hebrews 12. Verse 15 said, looking diligently, lest any man fail of the grace of God, lest any root of bitterness springing up trouble you, and thereby many be defiled. The other part of the curse is this. It defiles everybody around you. Have you ever met somebody who could walk into a room and just cheer the whole room up just by walking in and saying hello? I mean, some people just have that bubbly kind of personality. And by the same token, have you met somebody who could walk into a perfectly happy room and just bring a rain cloud with them? I mean, just boom. All of a sudden, ugh, it all just dies. And everybody's sitting there with a scowl on their face. Some of those things are contagious. Bitterness is like that. You put a bitter person in a room of perfectly happy folks, and the first thing they'll do is start going around and spreading their bitterness. They'll find somebody and they'll sit down and they'll give them an earful of why they're bitter and why they're angry and why they should be bitter. And it'll just spread and spread and spread until many are defiled. I was preaching in Texas. If something weird's going to happen to us, usually it happens in Texas. Texas or New Mexico. Those are the places where if something weird's going to happen, it'll happen. And I was preaching in Texas, and I had a Wednesday night free in between two revival meetings, one that ended on Sunday and one that started the next Sunday. And I had the weeknights in the middle free, and there was a preacher in the area that I'd met several times. He said, if you ever have a free night, please let me know because we'd love to have you. So I called him. I said, I'm going to have that Wednesday night free in between those meetings, and if you'd like for me to come, I'll come. He said, oh, that'd be great. Come on, we'd love to have you. So he gave me directions, and I followed the directions. And I don't get lost. But sometimes I do take the scenic route. And I took the scenic route around that city for a long, long time. Now, that was back in the old days before I was married. Now, since I'm married, my wife tells me that you can stop and ask directions. I'm not sure I believe that, but she seems to be pretty well convinced that there are times you should stop and ask directions. So what I have done for her is that there are times when she says, shouldn't we stop and ask directions? I'll say, if you want to, I'll pull over. You can run in and ask directions. Yeah. All I need is a few minutes to think. By the time she comes out, I've figured out where we're going. I don't like to ask directions. I prefer to be led by the Spirit of God. So I just kept going round and round and round in circles around that place. And as it turned out, he left out one of the turns in the directions. I would get to the down the street I was supposed to go, and then the next street just wasn't there. He left out one street. So I just kept going around, and that one, it's been a while ago. I didn't even have a cell phone back then. There was no way to call, and here I am in this strange town just going round and round, and I'm watching the time go. And church started at 7, and it was getting closer and closer to 7. I thought, I'm not going to make it. I've never done this before. I'm going to miss this church service. Finally, I stumbled on the right road, and boom, there I was. I pulled into the church parking lot at 7:05. I was nervous. I was just all, you know, I was all on edge, and I think the pastor was too, because he was waiting on the front porch. And I got up there, and he came out, and he said, "Oh, I'm so glad you made it. Let's go in the office and pray." I said, "That is a good idea. Let's go in there and pray. That will just help me, you know." So we went in there and we prayed, and that took a couple minutes. And then we had a couple more minutes before the service started. And he proceeded to tell me how every preacher within 100 miles was a sorry, low-down, no-good compromiser that wouldn't stand for anything. They'd had an issue in their town. And something wicked was going on. And the city was involved in it and all that. And this preacher heard about it, and he preached against it that weekend. He told the people why it was wicked and why they shouldn't be involved in it and why they should stand against it. And somehow the newspaper got wind that this preacher was against what was happening in town. So they came and interviewed him. Do you know what happens when a newspaper interviews an independent Baptist preacher? Bad stuff. It doesn't matter what you say, and it doesn't matter how you say it. They take it and they twist it around and they try to make you look like a goofball. That's what they do. They are masters at it. And that's what they did to him. They took little bits and pieces of what he said and just made him look like a lunatic. Well, that really made him mad. So then he decided next time that was going to happen in town, not only would he preach against it, but they were making signs and the whole church was going to go out and protest up and down the street. And he was calling every preacher within 100 miles to come join the protest. They made extra signs. The day of the big event came. And they got all their people together and they got them down there and got ready to march back and forth. And they were waiting for multitudes of others to show up and join the protest. And nobody came. Nobody. He told me one Assembly of God preacher pulled up, looked around to see what was going on, turned around and left. That's it. Nobody else. He called every preacher of every church within 100 miles. And in that part of Texas, you cover a 100-mile circle, you've got churches coming out your ears. I mean, they're everywhere. And that really made him mad. Now he was mad not only at the city and the newspaper, now he's mad at every preacher within 100 miles. I didn't tell him, but I'd just come from 50 miles away. And I knew some of those guys he was talking about. And none of them are perfect, but they weren't nearly as bad as he was making them out to be either. And the truth is, honestly, if I'd have been there, I don't know if I would have showed up for his protest. I don't know if I would have. Maybe, but maybe not. You know, sometimes there's just other stuff you need to do, and rather than go 100 miles away and hold a picket sign over something happening in somebody else's town, I mean, sometimes there's just other stuff you got to do. But he was mad. So he dumped all that on me, and then it was time for church to start. So I was, of course, nice and relaxed and ready to preach. No, the truth was, thank God I got to sing a couple songs, and that helped me a whole lot. It really did. It just got my mind going right and got my spirit all settled down, and everything was good. We had a good church service. Then we went out to eat that night, and we sat at this restaurant, sat there for about 2 hours. And all he wanted to talk about for 2 hours was how every preacher within 100 miles was a sorry, low-down, no-good compromiser that wouldn't stand against evil and wouldn't stand for truth. By the time he was done, I felt like somebody had taken a bucket of garbage and just dumped it on me. That's what I felt like. He just dumped it all over me, and I felt dirty. And I determined that night, I was staying in a prophet's chamber at the church. I determined I was going to get out of there the next morning before I had to go through that again. I just determined I was going to get out of there. I figured if I'm out of here before 8 o'clock, surely he won't be there by that time. I will get away free. I'll be free.
So I got everything together. 7:45, I put the last thing in the van. I went back in the auditorium, back in the church, dropped the keys on the secretary's desk. The big glass doors shut behind me. I was walking across the parking lot to my van and freedom. You'll never guess who pulled in the driveway. It's the pastor. Pulled in the driveway, rolled down his window. He said, "Oh, Brother Rogers, I'm so glad I caught you." I said, "You caught me. You caught me." Said, "I just wanted to say thank you for coming. And if you're ever in the area again, let me know. We'd love to have you again." I said, "Well, thank you. That's very kind." And then he said, "Of course, you'll probably never be in this area. There's really nowhere you can go within 100 miles. The rest of these guys are sorry, low down, no good compromisers. Won't stand for anything." I said, "Well, you know, I may not be back in the area." Truth is, I have been several times, many times. I've been real close to where he's at. Just never bothered to let him know. You know why? Because I really don't need to go through that again. That didn't help me. It didn't help me at all. Not at all. Last year, we were out in a church not too far from there. And I asked the pastor, I said, "What's going on with so-and-so down the road there?" He said, "Oh," he said, "he's nuts." I said, "Well, yeah, I knew that, but I wanted to know how he was doing." Sometimes a guy that's nuts does all right. You just never know. He said, "Well, you know, they had a big building project and all this and that. And when I was there, they were running, I don't know, between 200 and 300 people. Now they're down to 80 or 90 people. You know what the problem is? He never dealt with his bitterness. Never did. And the truth is, nobody wants to bring their family and sit and listen to a bitter man be bitter. Nobody wants to hear that. And they don't want to get it. They don't want their kids to get bitter. And they don't want their family to be bitter. And the truth is, if you dump bitterness on people long enough, they're not going to get bitter at nameless, faceless preachers 100 miles away. They're going to get bitter at each other. And they're going to get bitter at their own preacher. And they're going to get bitter and fight amongst themselves. And they are literally destroying their own church right there. Just destroying it. Sometimes churches go through awful things and they can come back and reach even greater heights than they did to start with. I've been to some where the preacher ran off with some woman and the church had good solid foundation and they've come back and gone beyond where they ever were, even with that kind of thing in their past. But you let bitterness infect the congregation. Let people get bitter and angry at each other and nobody's going to want to come be in that place. Nobody. It defiles many. Defiles everybody around you. But let me give you the cure. There is a cure. It's in Ephesians chapter number 4. Go back there again. Ephesians chapter 4. We read verse 30 and 31. Let's read verse 31 again. "Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. And be ye kind one to another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake hath forgiven you." You know what the cure is? You do, don't you? It's forgiveness. That's the cure. And as we read that verse, you saw that little word in there, forgiving one another. And some of you said, "Oh, I see. Forgiveness. Well, that won't work. I've tried that. That won't work. It's just not going to happen. You don't understand my situation. My hurt is real hurt. It's not imagined hurt, it's real hurt, and somebody did awful things to me and said awful things about me and ruined my life, and I just can't do that. They don't deserve to be forgiven." I believe you. I do. You're probably right. As a matter of fact, the truth is they're probably worse than you think they are. Really. They've probably done that same thing to other people. They probably have. And they're probably far worse than you would ever imagine. They are really low down and sorry and no good. They are. But the cure is forgiveness. That's the cure. If that won't work, there's no cure. Because that's what God tells us to do.
I want you to look at the verse again.
Forgiving one another, even as God, for Christ's sake, hath forgiven you.
Well, they don't deserve to be forgiven. You're right, they don't. Let me ask you a question. Don't answer out loud. Before you got saved, did you deserve the forgiveness of God? It's kind of a silly question, isn't it? You didn't. What you deserved was to spend eternity in hell. That's what you deserved. But because of what Jesus Christ did on the cross of Calvary, God forgave you. Not because of what you did, but for Christ's sake, because of what he did, God forgave you. And God says, I want you to forgive one another, even as God for Christ's sake hath forgiven you. You don't forgive somebody because they deserve it. You forgive somebody because Christ forgave you. That's the reason. They don't deserve it. You're right, they don't. But God says, just like I forgave you when you didn't deserve it, I want you to forgive them. You say, oh, but if I do that, they will turn around. They will do it again. They will. Now, please understand, forgiveness does not mean that you make yourself a doormat for wicked people. That's not what it means. There may be some folks that you just can't be friends with. You just can't spend time with. You just have to separate yourself from because they will do horrible things. You just can't be part of their life at all. But you still have to forgive. Because if you don't, it'll ruin your life. It'll ruin your life. If I forgive them, they'll go out and do it again. That's possible. It really is. But let me ask you another question. Since you've been saved, since that day, have you ever sinned? It's a dumb question, isn't it? Of course you have. You've done some things and you knew that they were wrong. And the Spirit of God got a hold of your heart, and maybe during a church service you got under conviction and you found yourself down at the altar pouring your heart out to God, saying, Lord, here's what I did. It's wicked. It's sin. You confessed that thing to him. And in essence, God said to you, you are forgiven, right? The forgiveness of God was right there ready for you, was it not? Surely. And then 6 months later, you went out and did exactly the same thing again. Not something different, the same thing. And again, God got a hold of your heart and you're down at the altar pouring your heart out saying, Lord, I did that again. It's wicked. It's vile. Lord, I'm so sorry. Please forgive me. And God, in essence, says, you are forgiven, right? And then 2 weeks later, you went out and did exactly the same thing again. Don't look so innocent. You've done this. We've all done this. And you find yourself down at the altar again, pouring your heart out to God, brokenhearted over your own sin. And God says to you, forget it, buddy. 3 strikes and you're out. There is no forgiveness for you. As a matter of fact, you're going to hell now. It's all over. That's it. That's all. I'm done messing with you. I thought when I saved you that you'd never do that again. And now you did it, and that's it. It's all over. Aren't you glad he doesn't do that? Do you think that when you got saved, God thought you would never sin again? Do you really think that? As a matter of fact, don't you think he knew that until the day that you stand in his presence and you're made just like Jesus Christ, as long as you're in this flesh, there are going to be sin issues? You think God knew that when he saved you? Surely he did. And he saved you anyway, right? Not because of what you did. It wasn't for your sake. It was for Christ's sake. He forgave you when you didn't deserve it. And he forgave you, knowing full well that you might go out and do again some of those things that you did before you were ever forgiven. And yet he forgave you anyway because of what Jesus did for you.
And he says, be ye kind one to another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake hath forgiven you. That is the cure. That's the cure. You might need to forgive somebody. You say, well, the person that I'm bitter at, they're long gone. There's no way I can forgive them. Well, you still need to forgive them. Even if you can't find them and you can't track them down, you need to, in your heart, forgive them. If you can find them and track them down, you need to do so and forgive them. You say, but if I do that, they won't even accept it. That doesn't matter at all. Doesn't matter at all. Because the forgiveness, again, is not really so much for them as it is for you. If you don't forgive, the bitterness will ruin your life. See, once you forgive, then the ball is in their court, so to speak. If they want to accept that and do right before God, that's wonderful. And if they want to refuse it and stay in a bad position, then that is between them and God. You can't fix that. You can't change that. But you can do right. And you can do what God told you to do, which is to forgive. The second part of that is to forget. It's to forget. Now, having said that, I know it's impossible. You can't. It'd be nice if you could say, I choose to forget this and this and this. I'll never remember it. God does that with our sin. But we can't do that. Once it's there, and we're stuck with it. So instead of really forgetting, what we have to do is do what Philippians 4:8 says and think about the right things. Things that are true and just and pure and honest and lovely and of good report. In other words, maybe that person turned on you and you went to church together and you spent time together and they were your friend. Then they turned on you and they hurt you. Now you forgive them and then you choose to think about the good parts. Remember when they were your friend? Remember when you sat in church together? Remember when you prayed together? Remember when you went out and knocked on doors together and you served God together? You're going to have to choose to think about that on purpose, or the devil will remind you of the hurt and the wounds, and he will replant those seeds of bitterness. Maybe you're walking through Walmart one day and around the corner comes that guy that said horrible things about you. Immediately, the devil's going to try to replant those seeds. So what you have to do is say, okay, Lord, help me to think about the right stuff. Help me remember something good. Something good, something positive. Help me to think about that. Because if you don't, the seeds will get planted. Here's a rough one. Maybe that ex-wife or husband that destroyed your life, just turned it upside down and devastated you. And it's been hard. It's been hard to overcome that, hard to forgive. And one day you're walking through Walmart. Best thing to do, stay out of Walmart. One day you're walking through Walmart and around the corner they come. And there they are. And the devil reminds you, boop, all the bad stuff, right? That's what comes to your mind. But remember, there was a day when you stood before a preacher or a judge or a priest or somebody somewhere, and you said you loved that person. You said that once. And you said there were things about that person that you admired and you liked. And you know what you're going to have to ask God to do? To remind you of those things. Because if you don't think about those things, instead you'll think about the hurt and the heartache. And Satan will plant seeds of bitterness. Maybe you got hurt somewhere along the line in a church. Maybe a preacher offended you or said something he shouldn't have said. I've been in places where preachers said stuff that was just mean. I mean, just mean and ugly. And just completely uncalled for. And I can understand how folks would be hurt by that kind of thing. You know what you need to do? Forgive. Forgive. You see, if you don't forgive, then the devil has won two victories. He got somebody up here to say something he shouldn't have said. That's one. And then he got you to be bitter. That's two. And he gets a free victory out of it. And we should never, ever give the devil a free victory. Ever. Never. So you need to forgive. Forgive. And every time that person's name is brought up, or every time you see them or see a picture or somebody says, hey, do you know so-and-so? The first thing the devil's going to do is remind you of the hurt. But what you need to do is say, Lord,
remind me of the good part. Remember the day when you heard him preach and he said something that allowed the Spirit of God to get a hold of your heart and do a great work in your life. Maybe it was because of that church that you got saved. Well, remember that. Thank God for that. Maybe it was there that you learned some truth that helped you grow in your walk with God. Well, then remember that. Because if all you think about is the bad stuff. Oh, and the devil's good at bringing up the bad stuff. Those seeds will get replanted. And it will damage your life. Remember, bitterness doesn't hurt the person you're bitter at. But it'll ruin your life. What we need to do is ask God to help us to be quick forgivers and forgetters. So that we can go on and serve him to the best of our ability. I don't know your situation. Maybe you don't have any problem with bitterness. But knowing human nature, we are prone to it. What we need to do is ask God to search our heart and show us where those seeds have been planted. And then with forgiveness, go back and pluck them out. And when they get replanted, go back and pluck them out again. And when they get planted again, pluck them out again. And every time, it'll be a little easier to get them plucked out. And they'll stay out a little longer until one day you can finally have victory over that hurt and that damage. Let's stand together and pray. Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, that you've forgiven us, not because we deserved it, but because of the cross. And Lord, you've told us that we need to forgive others. God, as saved people, we should be the most forgiving people in the world because we've experienced what real forgiveness is. We know what it's like to be guilty, to be wrong, and yet be forgiven because of something someone else did for us. Lord, help us to forgive that way. Lord, tonight, if there's one in this place that's never trusted Jesus Christ as Savior, I pray that tonight they'd come and experience what real forgiveness is all about. The forgiveness of sin. Sin forgiven, forgotten, forever. What a wonderful truth. Lord, tonight, I pray that you would show us those areas where those seeds have been planted, maybe a long time ago or maybe just yesterday. Show us those areas and help us to pluck them out with your forgiveness and your love. We'll thank you for all that you do in our midst tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. Pastor, would you come?